thanks so much for joining me here today as we get to talk about one of my favorite subjects, comic books. Well, in particular, we're going to talk about the Dark Phoenix Saga, which I have just finished completed. I do have a playlist. I cover classic X-Men. I started all the way at number one, and the Dark Phoenix Saga should be the last six episodes, I believe, on the playlist. Well, as of this video, there's probably more there now, but feel free to check them out if you would like. If you're interested to know which issues to look at, Classic X-Men 35, because that's how I covered them. So Classic X-Men 35 all the way through Classic X-Men 43. So when the Dark Phoenix Saga came out originally, I was 5 years old. So I was much too young to discover the series. This image that I'm showing you here of this cover by Bill Sienkiewicz is actually how I discovered the Dark Phoenix Saga. I started reading X-Men during the Mutant Massacre Saga. So about X-Men 210. That was my first issue collecting the X-Men. I have one issue that my grandfather had gotten to me, but I never kept on with the X-Men. A friend of mine in middle school actually got me hooked up on X-Men. And so I started buying from 210 forward. It's actually a great jumping point. It just happened to be a great jumping point. And Classic X-Men had just started to come out, so I jumped on it. So there was no internet back then, so I had to read these stories monthly. And all these backstories, one at a time, 1 month at a time. It took a while. So Classic X-Men, I believe, came out in 86. So that's when I started. This trade paperback, although it was originally released in 1983, it was I wouldn't say it was re-released. I went into a comic book store and they happened to have this thing. Cost $7 at that time. Now, you may go, nowadays, go, that's the price of a regular issue. I'm not too far off. They're $5 as of 2024. So it's not too far off from this. But this trade contained the entire Dark Phoenix Saga and had no covers. So it was a coverless thing. It had just an image and then the story. So I'd never seen the covers till Classic X-Men came out. I had no idea what they were. Although Classic X-Men had not caught up to this, I was already an X-Men fan, so I picked this up. And I was already familiar enough with the newer X-Men, already having read about 15 issues of Classic X-Men or so when I bought this. I read this and was just blown away. Now, you have to keep in mind a couple of things. This wasn't very common back then. What was done here, Watchmen had just come out recently, Dark Knight Returns. And even so, this story is not superhero deconstruction. So Miracle Man doesn't apply. Watchmen doesn't apply. Dark Knight Returns doesn't apply because those are all deconstructions. This was not a deconstruction. This was just an amazing story. And part of what makes it so amazing is it was organic. This wasn't a company trying to create a cash grab by doing some kind of event. There were no events. This book was between 1979 and 1980. So there were no events. This just happened to be a great writer with a great artist, which John Byrne is magnificent. He's also an incredible storyteller as well on his own right, crafting this amazing story. When you take what the Dark Phoenix saga was, it just had never been done before. I was blown away. Now, because at that time I was reading X Factor, I knew Jean Grey eventually came back. I had no idea how, because I never saw the Fantastic Four or the Avengers issues where they dug her up. I just sort of read it through X Factor. So I knew that portion of it, but I had no idea how incredibly amazing this would be. Marvel, in its creation, has done two stellar storylines. Three, okay, I'll be generous. I'll say three. So, the Dark Phoenix Saga, Born Again by Frank Miller and David Mazzucchelli featuring Daredevil, and then the Galactus Saga with Fantastic Four. All of those organic, all of those just stories as told in as we went along. No mandate. No, we're gonna rape people for all their money every summer, and we're gonna take away. This is gonna be the event. You're gonna buy it, and we're gonna throw 50 issues, and we're gonna make you pay $10 an issue because we're Marvel and DC, and this is what we want. This is what this wasn't. This was amazing stories told organically, which is what makes it so absolutely fantastic. When you read the Dark Phoenix saga without context, it's a good story, but it really doesn't have that emotional grab unless you read everything, starting with Giant Size X-Men number one, and you watch the entire transformation of Jean Grey to become the Phoenix, particularly through Classic X-Men, which is why I chose to cover this going through Classic X-Men because of all the amazing exposition that Claremont gave in Classic X-Men. So, in that playlist that I do, this is why I chose Classic X-Men as my as the reason why I decided to cover, because it really gives you a bigger picture to this entire mythology. And when you start with Giant Size X-Men number one and work your way through 94 and 95 and all those, the Death of Thunderbird and Dark Phoenix, oh sorry, regular Phoenix, which by the way was introduced kind of with a whimper. It really didn't, they introduced her, but then they laid her up in a hospital room for forever. So then they went with regular. I don't know whether Chris Claremont was trying to figure out or if he was playing the long game or whatever, but when Phoenix shows up in 101, she's just then ends up in a hospital bed because she's so weak and everything. So the X-Men end up having to go to Ireland with Banshee, where they end up fighting Black Tom and the Juggernaut. Again, I've covered all that, but my point is, you have to read the entire thing to get to the Dark Phoenix saga to then understand how amazing that story is and why I always recommend people to read the entire thing leading up to the Dark Phoenix saga, including Proteus, which is a very good story on its own. But then going through the Dark Phoenix saga. The Dark Phoenix saga is good because of everything that led up to it. So it's easy to say it's the greatest story when you have read everything up to that time, which I highly recommend. With Daredevil Born Again, you actually don't have to know anything about Daredevil. Daredevil Born Again, you can sort of read by itself and understand. There's no, you don't have to read like the first 20 issues of Daredevil to read Born Again. You can actually just read Born Again. With the Dark Phoenix saga, it doesn't involve a little bit more for you to be able to get that feeling. Because that feeling only applies when you have read everything and you then get that pop, you get that high of like, wow, what a freaking amazing story this is. So I recommend listen to all my videos, or you know what, even better than listening to my dorky voice, go buy the classic X-Men issues. They actually have been released. There's a two trade paperbacks that just have the supplemental materials. And if you get yourself like the Epic X-Men, it actually will tell you where these pages go in each issue of X-Men. So you can read regular X-Men and then go to classic X-Men, read the stuff, read the backup stories, and you get everything. The Hellfire Club, the more into Phoenix and Mastermind. Just so much exposition given in classic X-Men. If you don't want to read all the classic X-Men, feel free to listen to those videos. I know there's a lot asking you to go through 40 plus videos for you to get an entire story, particularly with my dorky voice. I get it. Not everybody's gonna do that, but it really will give you, like, as we go through that story, it's just great. And so to me, the Dark Phoenix saga is one of, if not the greatest story ever told at Marvel, but only when you read everything. As you read it by itself, it's very good. It's very, very good, but it doesn't have that emotional oomph unless you have been through the X-Men with all these battles and Wolverine's struggles and Cyclops' emotions with Jean Grey and then the Antarctica part with when they fought Magneto for the second time, and they thought one side thought the other side was dead, and just the entire thing. It's such a masterpiece. It's cinema, as Martin Scorsese would say. It is so goddamn good. What a freaking story. You also have to keep in mind that the Dark Phoenix saga is 45 years old now. And if you are a younger reader, you're used to stories like this. They happen all the friggin' time. Meaning superheroes dying and super, you know, that kind of stuff. It just didn't happen back then. When Phoenix died, it was something that, you know, to have a protagonist on a major book die, you know, when Thunderbird died, it didn't have the effect because he was brand new. Nobody knew who Thunderbird was. There wasn't years and years and years of a following. So when Thunderbird died in X-Men 95, people were like, oh, okay. When Jean Grey dies, it really, really, I mean, it just didn't happen. Gwen Stacy died, Uncle Ben died. Although even with Uncle Ben, you sort of feel bad for Peter, but you don't get that, oh my God, Uncle Ben, you know, but you feel bad because of how the story was done. With Jean Grey and Phoenix, I mean, you'd seen this character grow and evolve. There was an emotional connection, and it was just riveting. The Dark Phoenix saga is just so, the stuff that they did then, and I know you hear me say amazing and amazing and amazing and amazing, but it really was, it truly was a masterpiece in comic book storytelling. If you read the X-Men, especially like I told you, from Giant Size X-Men number one, like if you get the Epic Collection or anything like that, and you follow these characters, you get to know these characters. Like they were real people to a lot of people. The X-Men were real. As you read these stories, Chris Claremont is a fantastic writer. Yes, I complain a little bit because he's very wordy, and as I'm trying to keep these videos within a marginal time frame, going through these things, it's just he packs so much and much and much, but he's a fantastic writer, and the emotions and the it's just, and the relationship that Cyclops and Phoenix have, it's a real relationships. The stakes they faced off against every month were real. This is why this story is so good and so stirring. The ending, and most of you, if you don't know, there's plenty of YouTube videos out there. Originally, they were not going to kill off Phoenix. They just were going to have the amnesia thing, and then the editor of in chief at that time, Jim Shooter, said, "Nope, she killed all these people. She's going to have to pay." And so he had suggested the Shi'ar take her prisoner. But then Chris Claremont thought that would limit the storytelling because then the X-Men would spend the next, 40 issues trying to rescue her. And he decided that just wouldn't be good storytelling. So, they opted to kill her instead. Now, they said it was a bluff, but Jim Shooter liked it. I don't know whether it was a bluff or not. I think it worked. So that was a bit of controversy. You just didn't kill favorite characters at that time, but it really worked. Chris Claremont was actually not in favor of bring her back. In fact, he found out about it. He was told about it, and claims Shooter had told him that it would never happen, and he had promised it. But it's comic books, and when the idea for X Factor came up, they decided to resurrect her because they wanted the original five. So a lot of stuff ended up getting her origin, but it wasn't his idea. Regardless of the fact that she ends up coming back, although I believe they killed her again. It's just ugh. She's been killed so many times. It doesn't matter. It doesn't make this story less effective. I think, goodness gracious, I don't know what else to tell you about this story and how absolutely fascinating it is. It just, the movie that came out kind of based on it, it really wasn't that good. It's an unfortunate because you can't make people care in 2 hours. You have to, this thing took damn near 30, almost 40 issues to tell this incredible story. And it's not because they had the idea back then, but because it was a build to a build to a build to a build. If you can't find the classic X-Men issues, which is how I recommend it, I recommend classic X-Men. Buy them in your local comic book store, or get the trade paperback that collects the backup stories with the supplemental material, and then just get the Epic Collection, which will have just the regular X-Men stories, and then just find a ways, or watch the videos, or if you don't like my voice, find other YouTube videos out there. I'll just start from the beginning and go on this journey and love this story once you get the whole thing. I just cannot recommend enough of how great and meaningful this story is. I get excited talking about it. My goodness gracious, what an amazing story this is. So I'm going to finish this up here. When you reread this story, remember, if you just remember everything that happened to this, remember everything and work so that you feel this magical story, or take the time to just read the entire X-Men saga starting in Jan Saz. Reread this amazing story. It's just so freaking good. I don't know how else to explain how absolutely magical it was when I sat down on when I was in middle school and took that trade paperback that I showed you in the very beginning with that beautiful cover by Bill Sienkiewicz, and I read this entire saga in one sitting, just going, my God, I can't believe this. This is, you know, which is kind of funny, assuming, because even back then, this thing was about 5, 6 years old. But, I mean, Jesus, it was, like I said, there was no fucking internet. I had no idea all this stuff was happening or had happened. It was just pure gold. I hope you enjoyed my covering of the, not just the Dark Phoenix saga, but the X-Men going up to that time frame, and that you stick around for the remainder. I have X-Men videos come out every day. My plan is to go through all of Chris Claremont's run, and I chose to do it every day because I didn't want to do this for 15 years. I'm not only going to cover Chris Claremont's run in chronological order, in reading order. I'm going to cover his New Mutants run. I'm going to cover his Excalibur run. And I'm also going to be covering Walter Simonson and Louise Simonson's X-Factor run. So we are going to go through a lot of X-Men stories, particularly of this great era of the Chris Claremont. It is the best era of X-Men, hands down, compared to anything you read now. This is better than anything that is happening now, better than Bendis's run. Although, you know what, I like Bendis's run. A lot of people don't like it. I actually enjoyed it. I actually enjoyed X-Men versus Avengers. We're going to cover all the Chris Claremont era, as I like to dub it. And I hope you stick with me for that. Like and subscribe. I do thank you for listening. And I hope for those of you that watched this Dark Phoenix videos, I hope you enjoyed them, because I enjoyed the retelling of these stories and going through them with you so much. It was just such a pleasure. Have a great day, and thanks for listening.